The U.S. Coast Guard's Polar-class icebreakers, Polar Star and Polar Sea, are the most powerful icebreakers operated by the United States and are two of the most capable icebreakers in the world. I am Captain Bruce Toney, and I have had the privilege to command both the cutter Polar Star and the cutter Polar Sea. In this presentation, I will explain some of the characteristics and capabilities of these great ships, profile some typical missions, and provide some insights into the life and work of the crew. These photos and video were shot by numerous crew members serving on both ships over the past few years. Welcome aboard the Polar Star and Polar Sea. The United States first built heavy icebreakers during World War II, eventually producing 7 Wynn-class icebreakers, which were operated by both the Navy and the Coast Guard. In the 1950s, the Navy built one larger and more powerful icebreaker, the Glacier. In 1965, the Navy transferred the Glacier and their remaining Wynns to the Coast Guard, and since that time, the Coast Guard has been the sole federal agency operating icebreakers. As the Wynns and Glacier began to age, their replacement, the Polar Class, was designed with the capability to operate independently in the harshest of conditions. Construction began in Seattle in 1972. The Polar Star was commissioned in January 1976, the Polar Sea in January 1977. The Wynn Class and Glacier have since been decommissioned, and now, in 2006, the U.S. Coast Guard currently operates 3 large polar icebreakers. These icebreakers are all homeported in Seattle, Washington, and represent the total United States heavy icebreaking capability. In addition to the 30-year-old Polars is the cutter Healy. Commissioned in 1999, she is a highly advanced, modern ship oriented towards scientific research in the Arctic. Healy is larger than the Polars by 21 feet and almost 3,000 tons, has a different hull shape, extensive laboratories, and is very capable. But when you need sheer muscle, the hull form and more than twice as much horsepower make the Polars the breakers of choice. The Polar Class are 399 feet long, have a beam of 83 feet, at full load displace 13,500 tons, and have a maximum draft of 33 feet. The ships can generate up to 75,000 shaft horsepower and can break 6.5 feet of ice while continually moving forward at 3 knots, or ice up to 21 feet thick by backing and ramming. The hulls are specially designed for maximum icebreaking capability and strength. The cantilevered frames are spaced closely, and the special high tensile steel is able to remain strong and flexible at extremely low temperatures. The hull is 1.75 inch thick in the ice belt surrounding the ship. For reference, many regular ships have hull thickness of only 1/4 inch. Because the ships were designed to operate independently, in many cases away from potential help from other vessels, the Polars have multiple redundant systems placed in different compartments to ensure the ship's survivability and to have power in the event an engineering space is lost due to fire or flooding. The Polars were built with 2 independent and redundant propulsion systems, an 18,000 horsepower diesel-electric plant for transit steaming and light icebreaking, and a 60 to 75,000 horsepower gas turbine plant for heavy icebreaking. The diesel-electric plant consists of 6 large diesel engines similar to locomotive engines, which generate electrical power that feed the 3 6,000 horsepower DC motors. Each shaft also has available a gas turbine, which turns the shaft via a large reduction gear similar to a transmission. Each turbine is generally operated at 20,000 horsepower, although they are capable of producing 25,000 horsepower if necessary. The Polars have 3 large propellers, 16 feet in diameter, with 4 blades each. The propellers are known as controllable pitch because the blades are moved or pitched forward and back by a hydraulic system. This allows the shaft to continually spin in one direction at a constant speed. The pitch can be zeroed and reversed quickly with no adjustment to the shaft speed or need to slow or reverse the actual engines or turbines. Emergency gear and equipment is located throughout the ship in almost every compartment. The crew drill regularly to ensure they are prepared to meet any emergency. Each crew member, regardless of specialty or rank, undergoes extensive damage control and first aid training, and each has an assigned responsibility for every emergency. One of the biggest concerns at sea is fire. Unlike a building ashore, where the first response during a fire is to evacuate and call 911, at sea there is nowhere to run, and fires must be dealt with quickly to prevent their possible catastrophic spread. Due to the high volumes of fuel and numerous heat sources, our engineering spaces are one of our biggest fire concerns, and we have a pre-scripted response to almost any possible scenario in our machinery spaces. In our two diesel engine rooms and our turbine room, we have a halon gas flooding system which displaces the oxygen from the space, and we have a foam flooding system which fills the bilges underneath the equipment space with a soap-type foam which prevents spilled fuel from vaporizing. These two methods are employed first while fire teams are suiting up. The living conditions aboard the Polar class are some of the best in the Coast Guard or on any military ship. The large internal volume allows for multiple staterooms, lounges, rec decks, shops, office spaces, and storage areas. The majority of the enlisted staterooms for E5 and below are four person. For E6 to E9, the rooms are a mixture of singles and doubles. Officer staterooms are predominantly singles, with two double and two triples. The Polars have a large flight deck and an expansive helicopter hangar. Normally, two of the Coast Guard's shipboard deployable helicopters, the HH-65 Dolphin, are carried when an aviation detachment is assigned. The helicopters are employed in numerous ways, including to scout ahead for leads or openings while the ship is transiting in pack ice, flying personnel and supplies for logistics missions, conducting search and rescue as needed, law enforcement overflights, and conducting science support operations. While the ships are operating near McMurdo Station, the helicopters and crews deploy ashore and work directly for the National Science Foundation, carrying science teams to and from the field, as well as conducting logistics work for the ship and the science parties. The aviation detachment and aircraft were traditionally stationed in Mobile, Alabama at the Coast Guard's Aviation Training Center during non-deployment months. However, this division has recently been disestablished, and future aircraft support, when needed, will be provided from available Coast Guard air stations. The missions of the Polar class have varied over the years, and each ship has an extensive history of accomplishments, as well as a long list of remote locations and countries that have been visited. In 1994, the Polar Sea, in company with a Canadian icebreaker, became the first United States surface vessel to reach the North Pole. This feat has since been repeated twice by the cutter Healy. Both Polars have been used extensively in the Arctic, primarily on science expeditions, including transits of the Northwest Passage, and have conducted resupply operations for the U.S. Air Base in Thule, Greenland. However, the primary mission, and the one that each ship has conducted approximately 15 times, is the support of Operation Deep Freeze, the United States scientific expedition to Antarctica. The main objective of the Coast Guard support to Operation Deep Freeze is to assist in the resupply of McMurdo Station by creating a channel through the fast ice, that is, ice attached to the land, in the Ross Sea. This ice can extend outwards from 15 miles to as much as 85 miles each year, and can vary in thickness from about 6 feet to as much as 14 feet. One large fuel tanker and one large container ship, operated or contracted by the Military Sealift Command, then use this channel to conduct the once yearly resupply of McMurdo. McMurdo is the largest of the U.S. scientific bases and is the hub from which other science stations, such as South Pole Station, are resupplied via ski-equipped C-130 aircraft. McMurdo Station is located on Ross Island with Mount Erebus, a constantly steaming active volcano. Scientists and support personnel fly into McMurdo on Air Force cargo planes from Christchurch, New Zealand. Fuel, food, and building materials are shipped in each year via the two supply ships. McMurdo does not have a sufficient stock of fuel and supplies to continue operations if the resupply fails. Thus, the icebreaker's role is vital in the continued support of the multi-hundred-million-dollar science effort conducted in Antarctica each year by the National Science Foundation. In addition to opening the shipping channel through the fast ice, the polars conduct science operations, such as water sampling, setting current detection buoys, assisting in biological research under the ice, penguin studies, and even research on the orca populations. The polars are truly national assets as they have unique capabilities that no other United States ships possess. Like all Coast Guard cutters, the polars are multi-mission capable and are prepared for numerous contingencies. The ships are very self-sufficient, with the personnel and supplies to operate independently for extended periods of time anywhere in the world, especially the high latitudes, any time of the year. In addition to icebreaking and air operations capabilities, the polars also have the ability to carry numerous boats, including landing craft, well suited for operation in cold weather, but which have also been used to deliver relief supplies to tropical islands following a devastating cyclone. The ships have two 15-ton cargo cranes, which can be used to load up to 400 tons of palletized cargo into two cargo holds, where it can be secured through a system of metal battens and delivered to virtually anywhere in the world. The ships have extensive communications capabilities and can be used for almost any type of command and control operations. The Polar class carry over 1.3 million gallons of diesel fuel and carry sufficient food supplies to last approximately 1 year. The bridge, or pilot house, of a polar is impressive, stretching the full 83 feet width of the ship with excellent visibility and a height of eye of over 55 feet. The bridge contains a wide array of modern navigation and control equipment, including complete speed and rudder controls in three locations, three surface search radars, an electronic charting system with four video displays, as well as numerous radios, fathometers, and other sensors. While steaming in the open ocean, the bridge watch normally consists of five personnel. In the ice, this drops to three personnel, as the helmsman and lookout are no longer required. A flight following station is located on the bridge for air operations, with various radios and direction finders available to assist in controlling the aircraft. Because the flight deck is not fully visible from the bridge, a system of closed-circuit television cameras provide the necessary views and also allow the operations to be shown throughout the ship on the internal television system. The Polar class are generally controlled, or conned, in the ice from the aloft con. This small, fully equipped bridge is located on the mainmast 104 feet above the waterline. Aloft con is accessed by climbing inside the mast on four nearly vertical ladders reaching upwards over 60 feet. Everything necessary to con the ship, including a full set of controls, a radar, electronic chart display, radios, and other bridge items, are available. Aloft con is normally manned by two personnel and can comfortably hold four persons. The primary advantage of conning the ship from this area is that the officer of the deck is able to stand in one spot and see entirely around the ship while being able to simultaneously operate the helm and speed controls. During backing and ramming operations, the ability to see the stern of the ship is critical while backing in the ice because of the potential damage that could occur to the propellers or the rudder if the ship were allowed to strike hard ice while going astern. The engineering systems and equipment are complex and located in 11 different large compartments and numerous other smaller spaces. The engine rooms are not manned full-time, but are monitored and controlled remotely from the Engineering Control Center, or ECC. In addition to the two full-time watchstanders in ECC, roving watchstanders make hourly rounds of all spaces, and additional watchstanders from each engineering specialty are available at all times to respond as directed by the engineer of the watch. The tremendous icebreaking capability of the Polar class is derived from a combination of the specially designed hull form and the ship's extremely high horsepower. The bow of the ship is sloped such that it rides up onto the ice. This causes the stern of the ship to be forced down into the water, and a hammering action results when the force of the flotation in the stern pushes upward and combines with the downward force from the weight of the bow. The bow falls through the ice, and the powerful turbines surge to force the ship forward, and the bow again rides up onto the ice. Hull form, with no bilge keels, fins, or defined keel, is exceptional for breaking ice. However, during open ocean transits, it can produce a lively ride. The polar class are appropriately nicknamed the polar rollers and frequently roll beyond 45 degrees per side in relatively small sea states. The current polar manning is a crew of 134, augmented during deployments by a physician assistant and possibly an aviation detachment of up to 14. Berthing is available for science parties of up to 30 persons. The ship is organized into four departments: operations, engineering, deck, and supply. If an aviation detachment is assigned, they become the fifth department. There are 15 officer billets, one captain, one commander, two lieutenant commanders, one lieutenant, six lieutenant junior grades or ensigns, and four chief warrant officers. There are 119 enlisted billets. The most senior enlisted, or chief's mess, consists of four master chiefs, one senior chief, and 11 chiefs. Crew specialties include machinery technicians, repairing and operating the main engines, turbines, propeller pitch system, and auxiliary systems, electricians, providing both AC electrical service and DC propulsion power, damage controlmen, welding, repairing piping, and maintaining emergency equipment, electronics technicians, maintaining all electronic equipment and the engineering control system, an information system technician overseeing all computers and telephones, bosun's mates working on deck, small boats, cranes, and bridge navigation, marine science technicians operating science gear and forecasting weather, operations specialists conducting radio and satellite communications, food service specialists operating the galley and providing meals almost continuously, storekeepers purchasing and receiving all supplies and repair parts, a health services technician overseeing all crew medical needs, yeoman conducting administrative and personnel record tasks, 34 seamen working on deck, on the bridge, and assisting in the galley, 14 firemen working in the engineering department and assisting in the galley. The stateroom layout and berthing area arrangements allow for almost any combination of male and female crew members. Currently, about 20% of the crew are female, covering a wide array of specialties and ranks. Entertainment during the long deployments is extensive and varied. The ships carry over 800 movies and have a satellite TV system. The ships have extensive workout equipment for physical fitness, and the deck layout allows for running during good weather. Basketball and ping pong can be played in the hangar, board games are played on the mess deck, and a weekly game of bingo is enjoyed by many. While crossing the tropics, off time is enjoyed on Steel Beach, and in the polar regions, the opportunity to enjoy ice liberty is always highly anticipated. Both ships have a fully stocked ship store, which sells hats, t-shirts, candy, toiletries, and numerous other items. Both ships have an onboard coffee shop or espresso stand, serving up the ever-popular flavored lattes that a Seattle-based crew craves.